Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Donald Worcester, chair of the Humanities Lecture Committee for this year's Hall Center for the Humanities Lecture Series. If you've been reading your brochure, you know that this is the 50th anniversary year of this distinguished lecture series, which has brought over 150 scholars and public figures to the University of Kansas over the last half century. It is one of the oldest and most distinguished lecture series in the United States, and this year we are trying to do something special in honor of the 50th anniversary. I want to draw your attention to the committee who have been putting together this year's lecture series. They include, in addition to myself, Maria Carlson from the Russian and East European Studies Program, Peter Casagrande of the English Department and of the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, Janet Crow, Executive Director of the Hall Center, Richard DeGeorge of the Philosophy Department, Charles Eldridge, our Distinguished Professor of Art History, Elizabeth Kuznetsov of the History Department and Latin American Studies, Connie Menninger of Topeka and the Topeka Historical Society, Kansas State Historical Society. We have worked this year to present to you an unusually public group of speakers. And in this semester in particular, we've asked three speakers who will address the position and the status of the humanities at this point in our nation's history. As you are undoubtedly aware, the humanities have been a matter of some controversy over the last few years in both art exhibits, exhibits at the Smithsonian, in the interpretation of the humanities generally in this country. The humanities are about values, and values are themselves these days in this country in flux and debate and controversy. This semester for the Humanities Lecture Series, we have three speakers who will all speak to this question of the humanities in our public life and our public culture at this point in our history. Our next speaker will be Nancy Kassebaum Baker, former United States Senator. She will appear on March the 2nd at 8 p.m., not in this building, but in the new Free State High School Auditorium over on 6th and Wakarusa. And our last speaker of the semester will be the Chancellor of this university, Robert Hemingway, who will speak on humanities and American politics. And we will be back here in this building, the Lead Center, on April the 7th, 8 p.m. for that event. And now it is my pleasure to give you the person who will introduce tonight's speaker, Distinguished Professor of American Art History, Charles Eldridge, who is in the wings, coming out at this moment.
Thank you, Don, and good evening. It's a pleasure to welcome you this evening to a very special occasion. Over the years, there has been considerable traffic from Lawrence and Mount Oread to Washington, D.C. Professors and curators, graduate students, families, legions of them, migrating to the nation's capital to enjoy, among other things, the Smithsonian Institution's incomparable museums and research centers, and more recently, even to enjoy the Smithsonian's America or America's Smithsonian in Kansas City, which likewise attracted a huge turnout and great enthusiasm. Tonight, therefore, we are pleased to reverse the flow and to welcome to Kansas and to the university, from his castle on the National Mall, I. Michael Heyman, the secretary of that venerable institution. He has served in that office since September of 1994, when he became the 10th secretary and the first non-scientist to hold the position. Although a relative newcomer to the Smithsonian, Secretary Heyman is no novice to the field of education, nor a stranger to Washington. In Who's Who, he is identified tersely as administrator, educator, a label that scarcely begins to tell the story. He served as chancellor of the University of California at Berkeley from 1980 to 1990, an institution where he began as a member of the law school faculty in 1959. His distinguished teaching career has also included stints as visiting professor of law at Yale and Stanford universities. At Berkeley, he provided strong leadership in a period of transition for higher education strengthening particularly the university's biosciences departments and promoting ethnic diversification of the undergraduate student body, all the while maintaining the high academic standards for which that institution is universally acclaimed. In Washington, he has from time to time served various roles. Following his graduation from Dartmouth College, he worked as legislative assistant to Senator Irving Ives of New York State. Later, following military service in the U.S. Marines and after law school at Yale, where he was editor of the Law Review, he returned to the nation's capital as chief law clerk to Chief Justice Earl Warren from 1958 to 1959. More recently, he served as counselor to Secretary of the Interior Bruce Babbitt, as well as Deputy Assistant Secretary for Policy in the Department of Interior during the present administration. This estimable career in education and public service has included frequent involvement with American museums, a professional and personal interest which is shared with his wife, art historian Therese Heyman, who is currently retiring as senior curator of the Oakland Museum. In California, Chancellor Heyman was actively involved in the ultimate responsibility for distinguished museums which enliven campus life at Berkeley. He also served as a member of the Smithsonian's Governing Board of Regents from 1990 to 94, overseeing the institution's 16 museums and galleries, the National Zoological Park, plus scientific and cultural research facilities in 10 states and the Republic of Panama. Once upon a time, long, long ago, a legendary member of the museum profession, Chick Austin, the longtime director of the Wadsworth Athenaeum in Hartford and of the Ringling Museum in Florida, Chick Austin defined the purpose of such an institution. A museum exists, he said, for the amusement of its director. Well, the times have certainly changed. Today, the American Museum is at once a custodian of cultural and scientific treasures, an educational center, a publishing empire, a temple of tradition, a social hive, and simultaneously an agent for social change, a monument to local, state, or, as in the case of the Smithsonian, national pride, and much, much more. With such multiple expectations and obligations imposed by new and expanding audiences, the dedicated men and women who manage and operate these institutions, both museum professionals and lay members of their governing boards, are subject to new and competing claims, which lead to exhibition dilemmas, the subject of Secretary Heyman's address this evening. Please join me in welcoming Michael Heyman to the University of Kansas.
Good evening. Some time ago, well before I began serving as the Chancellor of the University of California at Berkeley, people said that the once coveted position of head of a university or college resembled a hot seat more than a chair, academic or otherwise. Only the brave or foolhardy need apply. Well, then I went on to take what promised to be the gentler role of Secretary of the Smithsonian Institution. If you read the papers, I don't have to tell you that this prediction proved false. These are days of ferment in the modern museum, as you've just heard. In the case of certain exhibitions, that on the Enola Gay is the preeminent example for me. The very fate of the Republic seems to be at stake in the ferocity of the discussion. But even when the stakes are not so high, our society has begun to think that what happens in exhibitions is increasingly important, both as a reflection of community need and of public discourse. The problem, of course, is that we don't all agree what these responsibilities are and how they're to be exercised. This is a comparatively new development. Some might date it back only to the 80s. And I think it has caught many by surprise, both museum professionals and their many publics. I appreciate the opportunity that the University of Kansas has provided me to sort out my impressions of the changing expectations confronted by the modern museum and the extent to which I agree and I disagree with colleagues and critics caught with me in this whirlwind. This is not the place to trace the origins of museums in Western societies, but most of us remember the traditional notion of museums as temples in which objects of curiosity, of beauty, of social importance were displayed. Although they were not, by today's standards, places of dramatic controversy, it is wrong to assume that they were passive or neutral. Museums were generally considered selective environments of the best and the beautiful, and they exercised their considerable social authority and professional expertise in the setting of standards and the conferring of status. The deference that communities paid to the authority of museums had something to do with the investment that their supporters had in the values and the standards and the aspirations represented by high culture, especially in art, but in science and history too, as it was then conceived, and the exclusion of other voices and perspectives. But even that deference was not absolute. It was conditional upon the curators fulfilling their noble trust as classically defined. In my view, the notion of the museum as a place of higher purpose has not fundamentally changed in recent decades. What has changed is the current absence of consensus as to what that higher purpose is. In an increasingly democratic and fractious society, struggles of taste, of collection strategy, of interpretation, and of national ideals, among other contentious issues, have waged in one of the last frameworks of validation in our society. Some are struggling to maintain the ideal of a museum as a place to contemplate masterworks of high culture. They will find their greatest satisfaction in museums exemplified by the National Gallery of Art in Washington, the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, or the Louvre, and will be outraged to see the attention of any museum diverted from these purposes. Others hold to the notion of the temple, but seek wider subject areas of veneration. The National Air and Space Museum at the Smithsonian was created in that spirit and continues to hold that meaning for many, as does our National Museum of American History. Ironically, even many who challenge the traditional notion of museum as a temple of universal values seek its authority as a mode of instruction, redress, catharsis, and often validation of their particular values. Most recent exhibition struggles have come of that intention. The symbolic stakes for the meaning of a museum today are perhaps the highest of all at the Smithsonian, for we have become a field of moral battle in the heart of the nation's capital. How a public and national institution responsible to many diverse audiences should respond to that struggle is the challenge that daily confronts me as secretary. While the controversies of recent years have particularly centered on issue-driven exhibitions and will be my final subject tonight, I think it's important to spend a moment on other areas of controversy which touch on fundamental beliefs about museums, but may not be as apparent to those outside our daily work. What a museum collects and chooses to display can be as much an occasion for outrage as the most forcefully argued exhibition. This can take quite surprising forms. I can't resist telling you, for example, that not long after I arrived as secretary in 1994, I was confronted with the following newspaper report, and I quote, "Paperweight collectors are in an uproar over the Smithsonian Institution's decision to remove its collection of paperweights from permanent display." That's the end of the quote. But the article goes on to describe a charge that the Smithsonian favors German ceramics over American paperweights, and reports a letter-writing campaign of upwards of 10,000 letters and an intention to lobby foundations in Congress in protest against us. I could laugh at the beginning of 1994, but I have learned never to underestimate the meaning that people attach to every Smithsonian action. But frustrating matters of that sort aside, the Smithsonian's collecting policies have stirred genuine and necessary debate on what does and does not belong in a modern museum. In the late 70s, the loudest protest registered about Smithsonian policy came with the decision of curators in what is now the National Museum of American History to accept into the permanent collections such items as Archie Bunker's chair from the hit television series All in the Family, or Fonzie's jacket from Happy Days. This was seen by some as a lowering of standards and a capitulation to commercial culture. I might say capitulation is a word that is used often in the museum community. That those objects held immense meaning for millions of Americans was not viewed by these critics as sufficient reason for their inclusion. Ellen Hughes, the curator, who went through those earlier culture wars, has written a fascinating account of the controversy as one essay in the book Exhibiting Dilemmas, produced on the occasion of the Smithsonian's 150th celebration. For those of you who think that that particular battle is over, I refer you to the many articles written in condemnation and in support of our current Star Wars exhibition at the National Air and Space Museum. It has, of course, been a monumental hit with our public. This particular controversy over the inclusion of popular culture in the Smithsonian's collections is one where the general public seems squarely behind the transformation of museum policy, while many, but by no means all, in intellectual circles are opposed and even outraged by what seems to them a violation of museum purpose. But there are, of course, many instances where attitudes about appropriateness are completely reversed. One example concerns an entire field, that of contemporary art. Those within the general public who expect an art museum to represent a noble and serene vision of beauty and taste will be stunned by a visit to a great contemporary art museum such as the Hirshhorn at the Smithsonian. As my colleague Jim Demetrian, director of that museum, put it, and I quote, "In a museum of contemporary art, the artists and their works are in your face, very confrontational, pounding ideas, not always pleasant ideas, into your head, into your eyes, and sometimes into your ears as well. As a consequence, the museum, as a place to escape, is no longer possible, and the viewer becomes someone who, at times, is even assaulted, one might say, by what one experiences. And let's be honest, some of our visitors don't wish to have their senses or their sensibilities assaulted or offended." That's the end of the Demetrian quote. Demetrian may regret the displeasure or incomprehension some may feel when confronted by the art in his museum, but he makes no apologies for that art. Nor, of course, should he. His mission, the mission of his museum, defines his subject matter. And any in the public unaware of that mission needs to be alerted to it before deciding to visit. We on the National Mall, of course, have particular need to inform the public because many are on a national pilgrimage and have no background at all in contemporary art. You have noticed by now that I'm not one who believes that modern museums, even national museums, with the public eye fixed firmly upon them, should avoid tough subject matter. We must take on the diverse topics and perspectives of the 20th century, be they in popular culture, contemporary art, or a plethora of other frameworks. But what does seem to me a critical concern, and yet one rarely addressed, is the need to think about the context and the manner in which new forms are presented and new issues raised. Presenting an in-your-face work in the Hirshhorn is one thing. Presenting it in an exhibition in another of our museums or galleries can be quite another. One must think about the context and, if deciding to go ahead, about the extensive need for preparation of the audience. I think it's quite significant that the first major explosion in the current style of public outrage about curatorial presentation at the Smithsonian happened not at the Hirshhorn, which has taken on some very tough subjects, but at a museum few expect to be untraditional, the National Museum of American Art, which some of you here have had experience. The occasion, as some of you know, was the West as America exhibition. Presented in it were paintings and sculptures, some quite well known, of heroic landscapes and depictions of the Western movement in the United States. What then caused the stir? The text which accompanied these classic images in American art reinterpreted them according to theories current in academia, but unknown to and unexpected by a wider public. Many visitors came expecting to see beloved Western landscapes and were confronted at every point by labels which asserted new meaning, chiefly related to the fate of victims of Western expansion, Indians, Mexicans, and women, to name just three groups. The tone of the labels was assertive, and very little preparation was offered unwary visitors. The more traditional interpretation of Western expansion and Western art went unacknowledged, as did the perspective of participants at the time. One university teacher took her class through the exhibit, but asked them not to read the labels. They emerged wondering what the fuss was all about. The fuss, I think, in this wordy exhibition was about the mutual incomprehension of two cultures, that of the scholarly academy and that of the general museum going public, certainly that museum going public that visits us in Washington. It illustrated that many curators now see their roles as being those of participants in academic discussion, presenting a particular contemporary or pejoratively, isn't it strange, as it stated, revisionist view to their audiences. But very few visitors to such exhibitions come to museums, particularly national museums, with those expectations. My point is not that museums shouldn't challenge their audiences or make them aware of significant issues. But I do feel that it is naive at best and arrogant at worst for curators to fail to understand the universe in which they operate and to ignore how messages are transmitted and received. Museums can no longer be places indifferent to important issues raised by portions of their collections, but curators will have to do more than simply assert their new roles. They will have to figure out their implications and how to get audiences to relate to the new interpretations being offered. The argument is made that curators should be afforded freedom to present their views largely unsupervised by the directors of the museums in which they work. This is the academic model that guided my conduct for 35 years at Berkeley, the last 10, as you know, as chancellor. I believe, however, that there are differences between a university and the museum world of the Smithsonian. For one thing, a university is not responsible for the opinion expressed by its faculty. That's the consensus opinion. Universities have presidents and chancellors, not directors. They are places where discretion is attributed, whether in signed publication or in the person of the lecturer, and where the range of scholarly debate is acknowledged and monitored within each learned profession. And not least among the differences, the audience for their scholarship is self-selected, whether in the profession as a whole or in the lecture hall. Students come expecting contemporary interpretations and argument. Curators who use the academic voice in their exhibition scripts do what other scholars cannot. They present their viewpoints anonymously in a context where the audience historically have taken them as the authoritative statements of the museum, and in the case of the Smithsonian, perhaps, of the nation. Professor Neil Harris of the University of Chicago, who is both a student of museums and a participant in academic life, calls the voice of scholarly opinion when anonymously presented in a museum exhibition potentially authoritarian in its effect. At this point of transition in the museum world to a more democratic and responsive public role, we must be careful not to appropriate for our own views the temple's traditional authority. If we are committed to change the old elitist notion of the museum, we may not tap into its fundamental impulse to tell you what to think, even if the thinking we do is new. This does not mean, and I repeat, that no challenging issues can be raised in museums. It does mean that they have to be presented in open ways. We can't dictate a perspective, however conceived we are of it, or rather convinced we are of it, but we can offer it in context and provide the framework for an open discussion. This is the museum as a forum, not as a temple. Interestingly, in response to the controversy about the West as America, the director set up a public panel in which a variety of responses to the art were aired. Had this, in hindsight, happened as a strategy of presentation, along with the curator's introduction of a new set of ideas about Western art, a great deal of anguish might well have been avoided. We must explore and present the complexities of our topics, and we must be mindful that most in our audiences are perfectly willing to deal with new ideas and interpretations, not always, of course, agreeing with them, if they don't feel that their own are despised. Now let me take a moment to discuss the controversy which surrounded the proposed exhibition on the Enola Gay, the plane that dropped the first atomic bomb on Hiroshima. I suppose there may be someone left in America who has not heard about the Fuhrer, but I doubt it. I won't belabor every point, every blow by blow, but I would like to give you my view of what went wrong in the light of my other comments of tonight. First of all, it's important to say that at its fiercest, the controversy was not about an exhibition, but about a potential exhibition. It's to me inexcusable that the first draft submitted by the curators was seized upon by the press and others as though it represented final views. Many other drafts were produced, but their emerging conclusions were drowned out by the furor over the first. Terrible things were said by hostile critics and advocates alike, each imagining any opposing view is motivated only by political agendas, never honest convictions. I still get letters suggesting either that the curators were plotting against the well-being of the nation, or on the other side, that outraged veterans were indifferent to human suffering. That being said, I do wonder at how single-minded the exhibition was in its original conception, and whether we lost an opportunity for a full, inclusive discussion across the generations of a critical moment in national and world history. The museum's goal, I very much believe, was honorable and important, to provide a context in which to understand the significance of the Enola Gay. The problem was that the context originally was assumed to be, for purposes of the exhibition, the consequences of the bombing immediately and far into the post-war period, not the events that led to the decision, for instance, Japanese aggression in China starting in 1937, the events like Pearl Harbor of 1941 and 42, Bataan, Hong Kong, and a variety of other campaigns culminating in Okinawa. Without those, one had only half a context. It may be that the museum assumed the earlier story was well known, but that assumption itself had to be tested in advance. Moreover, it seems that the curator's goal was mainly to bring a modern perspective to bear on the meaning of the bombing, rather than to see as well the decision from the perspective of the era itself, including those thousands of grateful American soldiers, most or many at least still surviving, of varying backgrounds and political perspectives. Had the whole context been presented initially, much of the public anger and agony might have been avoided. Of course, I can't be certain of that. It didn't occur, and there are those in my community who say that it wouldn't have mattered. I think it would have. But the balance of context would require the exhibition neither to start with the dropping of the bomb, which had really been the curator's conception, nor end with the dropping of the bomb, which is what a number of critics proposed. It's the whole story that really had to be told. It's very possible to imagine an exhibition which recognized that significant numbers of American lives and the lives of others, including Japanese, were saved by the use of the bomb, and yet which also acknowledged the terrible pain of those affected by the bomb on the ground and the potentially dangerous precedent established for the use of the bomb in wartime. Granted, this approach does not privilege, to use a current term, the position that the use of the bomb was inexcusable and unnecessary, as some would have had, nor that the use of the bomb was a decision that no one should be allowed to dispute. But that's just the point. Had the discussion of the proposed exhibition not gone terribly wrong, and had the timing of the exhibition not confounded the expectations of those who were planning a celebration at the end of the Second World War, we might have been able to present a model of the museum as a forum. I might say that was my first experience with the 50th anniversary. My second currently is the 50th anniversary of the creation of the State of Israel, and I'm having similar problems. It really worried me to come here on the 50th anniversary of the humanities lectures. What I ask for in the context of the Enola Gay, then, is a reconsideration of the position that many may hold that the only issue at stake in the Enola Gay controversy and in similar exhibition controversies is the right of a curator to propound a particular position. The broader issue for me is the proper function of a museum in a democratic society. In a recent issue of Museum News, Robert Archibald, president of the Missouri Historical Society, put it well in my view. He said, "Museums that purport to serve disparate public audiences cannot claim to share authority with that public while simultaneously insisting that in cases of disagreement, principles of academic freedom shall apply and the curatorial point of view prevail. There are indeed multiple perspectives on enduring historical issues. We cannot be the final arbiters of the legitimacy of those voices. But what we can do is to find ways to demonstrate the multiplicity of perspectives on important questions and traditions. This might be achieved through any number of strategies. I heard, for example, on a recent trip to France, of a museum in the eastern region of that country, which took as its exhibition strategy the analysis of an important event of World War I in parallel commentaries by French, English, and German historians. The same could be done on any critical subject with voices from within a society, particularly one with as rich a mix of cultural, regional, and moral perspectives and experiences as our own. From within the Smithsonian itself, I take as another model the exhibition strategy of our latest museum, still in creation, the National Museum of the American Indian. The stance of that museum is inclusive, particularly of voices within the Indian community who have rarely had an opportunity to be heard. The anthropologists and others who have traditionally controlled the message about these cultures presented in museums will now have to share public attention and even the definition of what constitutes knowledge. It is a museum that might yet set the standard for others in this new era, with exhibitions that account for a variety of viewpoints within its community of concern, and which invite both traditional experts and the general public into its conversations. The success of the fair-minded approach of the National Museum of the American Indian reflects a broader truth about the modern Smithsonian. Those of you who know nothing about us except what you read in the papers will be under the impression either that most of our exhibitions and presentations are rife with controversy, or that no innovative ideas or challenging new positions are acceptable in the current climate. In fact, most of what we do never reaches the headlines, precisely because of the sophisticated approach most of our museums take towards subjects that deliver new information or new perspectives. Usually, subjects are simply not potential hot buttons for contention, but when they are, as for example, in our permanent installation at the National Museum of American History, on the Japanese-American internment camps, the curators found a way, through respect for the history of the times and reference to national ideals, to invite consideration of an unhappy chapter in our national life. The title of the exhibition, "Towards a More Perfect Union," says a great deal about the curator's intention, not necessarily to provoke, but to engage. In the same spirit, we are now planning an exhibition on the role of sweatshops in American labor history. In it, we take care not to characterize negatively an industry as a whole. We point out best practices as well as practices that must be decried. It is a matter of tone, of context, and of inclusion of more than one viewpoint. The same is true for challenging looks at such environmental issues as the threatened fate of the tropical rainforest and of the oceans, which were each the subject of major exhibitions. Within them, a full range of tough questions were addressed, but the public's awareness was raised, not necessarily their blood pressure. Another important element of credibility is the matter of whether the public believes we are in charge of our own exhibitions and programs. We risk that credibility anytime we accept co-sponsorship for an exhibition or program from an organization with an investment in the American public's view of the subject. I admit that it's easier to explain when balance in exhibitions is threatened than to present any ironclad formula for fair-minded presentation of tough issues. In some cases, I think we have to fairly judge whether the timing is right to present an issue in a national museum. If we plan to go ahead, then once we are assured that basic facts are separated from interpretation, we might present alternative interpretations, or equally unusual in today's museum, might ask the presenter to sign the exhibition and to prepare publicly to defend the viewpoint. Had we presented the Enola Gay question as, among other matters, a dialogue between World War II and Vietnam era generations, I wonder whether a healthy rather than a corrosive debate might have ensued. All I'm saying in the end is that if we are to take seriously the goal of the museum as forum, it is our responsibility to facilitate discussion, not foreclose it. In the last few weeks, I learned from Rick West, the director of the National Museum of the American Indian, that the word Potomac is a version of a term used by Washington's original inhabitants to describe a gathering place. If the Smithsonian can figure out a way to represent in the national imagination a gathering place of many publics rather than a battleground in which one side or the other contends for its desired authority, it will then be truly ready to be a museum of the next century. Thank you. From that audience that's somewhere out there, it's hard to see you.
It's a little hard to see hands going up here, but if you have a question or if you want to put to him, Ann Harvey.
Can you expand a little bit on comments about attribution of authorship and exhibits, making a clear communication to the audience of how the coverage of the topic came about and who was responsible so that they have a face to address their comments?
Yeah. Well, I think that's one way under some circumstances where we can at least divorce the museum from the responsibility for the presentation. I think that we have, at least in my museums, never done this as far as I know. And audiences to an exhibition in which that was done dramatically would find it that they didn't really understand what it meant. But it would be the beginning of the invitation to a dialogue with a specific person with a point of view. And then it would have to be facilitated, obviously, by opportunity to have discussions, probably in formal settings, I mean formally set, in which the curator of the exhibition, or in our case, the curators of the exhibition, would perhaps have a forum in which they answered questions and they defended their positions. Best of all, I suspect, would be that a session would be created, probably by those same curators, in which people who had other points of view also presented them. So it made it, in fact, a discussion forum. But what it would do is that it would begin to divorce the museum from the responsibility for the viewpoints in the presentation. So we could more look at the museum as a place where an event occurs rather than the place that puts them on and is responsible for them. I'd really like to see some experimentation along those lines, because if we're really serious about the museum as a forum, we've got to find different, various ways of stimulating people to accept that that's what the museum is, and not simply is the authoritative place that states what is the correct interpretation of whatever it is, but invites a conversation, discussion about that. I tend to believe that narrative shows are somewhat better than shows that simply show objects, for a lot of reasons. I think building context of some sort or another really lets the viewer into it, the potentialities of a much deeper appreciation of whatever it is. Just as an aside, I think of Bruce Nauman exhibition at the Hirshhorn. Nauman wrote his own labels, and they were absolutely wonderful, in which he tried to explain, he did explain, from his own, what this was about, what this work of art was about. For a person like me, who's really not very schooled in contemporary art, it was an absolute breath of fresh air to at least understand the artist's context for the creation of each of those works of art. But anyway, generally speaking, I really believe that that is a good thing. What I'm really asking for is that an audience see differing interpretations of the same. What I said to the director of American Art, I came on the Regents after that show went up and there was controversy, and she and I chatted, and I said, wouldn't it have been interesting if you would put two sets of labels up, one with the usual conventional way to describe this, and the other, the countercultural one, the new way of describing it. And at the very outset said, look, there are different ways of seeing these things. We're not telling you what to believe, but now you look at these differing interpretations, differing context, rather, of these same pieces. There are times, however, when I think the objects alone do a pretty good job. And I wondered a lot when we put together America's Smithsonian, which, as you know, came to Kansas City. A lot of the objects there we put up without hardly any context. I was astounded at what people brought to many of these objects. Now, they were icons of American history, largely. And if you looked at the Vin Fizz, you didn't necessarily have to be reminded of the whole history of the Wright brothers to understand this was an extraordinary vehicle that had come about soon after the Kitty Hawk and had, I mean, you could capture that and you could bring your own experience to bear with regard to that. If you looked at Lincoln's hat and knew that was the one that he was wearing on the evening that he was assassinated, you really, I don't know what we would have added. I just watched people as I came to that exhibition stand around that one case with that hat, some for 10 or 15 minutes, mesmerized, and you knew that there were so many things going through people's heads with respect to looking at this and bringing back true and false memories, but nevertheless connecting to this object with their own memories, which I suspect were much more powerful than anything we could have created for them. When they looked at Mercury capsule, the first one that went up, I must say, especially when the pilot of that, it came to one of these shows and exhibited himself and said a few words, you could see how could somebody get into that little thing? How could they? In other words, there are objects that carry their own explanation to them, and can in themselves do something which probably doesn't happen to the same extent when there's a lot of words and a lot of explanation and a lot of stated context which is get the viewer in an emotional way that otherwise would not maybe occur. And I do think that museums are not just for the head, they're really for the heart. And that's the difference, really, between a lecture like this and going to a really first-rate exhibition, that you're gripped in different ways emotionally by seeing objects, by seeing either of art or of historical significance or what it is. You're gripped in a way that you're not otherwise. So I think there's room for both. And it depends a lot on the object.
You talked about trying to maybe reconfigure the Smithsonian as more of a forum, and you've used the idea that this is a more democratic society. Now, usually when I think of a forum, I think ultimately a majority deciding how to proceed. Do you think that there are adequate safeguards for the Smithsonian to prevent, let's say, a transient majority right now in a powerful position, like, say, the United States Congress, from setting in some kind of way your exhibition agenda?
Oh, I think that's always a threat. I clearly do, especially now, given the intensity of what we all have been talking about. It's the cultural wars. I think that one of my responsibilities and others who are in leadership roles in museums is to try to create a setting in which it's less likely rather than more likely that kind of intrusion will be successful. I often wonder, although I have convinced myself otherwise, that my notion of giving more than one interpretation of a set of events is the best defense against intrusion that I know of. I know that I can go before any congressional committee in defending an exhibition that does things they don't like, if I in good faith can say, look, we have given different interpretations of the same event, and it's up to our audience to make a determination of what they believe. It's very hard to come down hard on me and my institution if I in good faith can state that. So I think that both as a matter of function of museums on the one hand, but also as a matter of good politics presently, this way of proceeding is a very sensible way of proceeding. Well, surely, and I really haven't ordered those all in my mind. I've thought about that a bit, though. I would find it very difficult to have for my own taste and my own demands, an exhibition that applauded slavery. I just would find that difficult. I would find it very difficult to contemplate in the Natural History Museum that we would have an exhibition that decried evolutionary theory. I mean, there are some things that in my own head are so set that they don't fit within this realm that I'm talking about presently. And the other thing my analysis presently is really applicable for 5 or 10% of what happens in the museums of the Smithsonian. 80, 90% of what occurs in the museums, these issues don't even arise. I mean, if you're going to have a gem hall and a minerals hall, which is a wonderful place, I don't know what the contentions are with respect to the identification of those minerals or all of the rest that applies to them. So there's a lot of stuff that goes on with regard to the Smithsonian where this analysis isn't highly relevant. But I appreciate your insight, and it's not one that I have fully. None of these things have I defined in an exclusionary way yet. I haven't found the boundaries of them yet, But I'm similarly troubled by the, as you are, by the potentialities of some of their applications. Yes? Well, I'm saying it's a kind of a teaching institution, and it's a kind of a teaching institution in which this kind of presentation seems to me most apt. I'm saying there are a lot of other kinds of teaching institutions that that don't have to worry themselves about these kinds of matters. One of the things is, I mean, I really believe in the museum as an educational institution. But I do think that we've got to be at the Smithsonian, and I can't talk for other museums, really, where about 80% of our visitorship are one-time shots of people coming to visit the national capital, okay? And they're coming through, and they're spending not a heck of a lot of time at each of these exhibits. The idea that we are teaching anything in depth is a little troubling, and I must say that one of the things that trouble me the most about very wordy exhibitions with a lot of words is that as I look at the audiences going through those, about 2% of them ever read the materials. And they are in fact relying on the objects, whatever all of those materials surrounding them are. So I take at least our setting, given what I've just described, as one in which we have to deal much less in depth, okay? So my sense is that if we're gonna do that, it's really important that we be balanced, that we try not to say too much, but whatever it is, we give opportunity for choice in that kind of an environment for those who come. So I feel quite differently if I'm thinking about my teaching classes as I have, and I probably will again, at Berkeley. I just see it such in a different environment. Thank you very much.